talk from Martin Graesslin, who, if you don't know, is the maintainer of KWin, the open window initiative that doesn't make me want to destroy my computer. And he's going to talk about Wayland.
So. The talk announcement was welcome to Massachusetts. And given the recent developments on the plasma front, especially as you have seen, we are running full Wayland on the plasma phone. I thought it's not fitting anymore to say we are on the road to Wayland, we are in Wayland. So welcome to Wayland. What you see here is a plasma session running on Wayland with Ocular running on Wayland, with an Ocular window in full screen on Wayland with Gwen powering everything. We don't have proper multi-screen support yet, so it might be that some areas are cut off. So please excuse that, that's still under development. Some people were not able to deliver the case screen changes. also, we are not yet able to hide the cursor, so that's why we have the cursor there. So, in this talk, I want to first again give a small look on the current architecture. Then I want to talk a little bit about the evolution of KWin, so the things we actually changed to be able to become a Wayland compositor. Then I want to talk about something which we jokingly call the KWin D project. And last but not least, a short outlook on what will be next, so what will come in Plasma 5.5 and Plasma 5.6 and so on. So let's start with the architecture. That was the architecture slide I presented last year. Most notably, we still have a few red arrows. Red meant everything which wasn't implemented at that time. And we had here Weston in between, so we were not yet able to handle Wayland clients. We were not yet able to handle input. And we still needed another Wayland compositor to do our Wayland work, our low-level work. So what changed in between? Our architecture doesn't have red arrows anymore. And for those people who remember, that was the final architecture stage which we will reach in my presentation at the Desktop Summit 2011. So we have reached the final architecture stage. We are a Wayland compositor. We get input events directly from the kernel. We render directly to the kernel using direct render management and kernel mode settings. We have a rootless X server to support legacy X applications. Our Plasma shell is running at the Wayland client directly connected to the Wayland server. So yes, everything from an architecture point of view is done. Now this slide, which I didn't change, is not completely correct, because that is not the only way we support Wayland nowadays. Because nowadays we also have backend plugins to support different platforms. So to say it's a little bit of an internal platform abstraction, so a little bit like QPA, and we use it for very similar things like QPA. So this platform abstraction creates OpenGL contexts for us. It powers the QPainter backend because we need platform-specific code for that. We get output information like how many screens are connected. Like in this case, we have two screens, so our backend needs to provide, hey, here are two screens. And some backends need to provide input handling. Not all do input handling themselves. For everything else, we have libinput, which is currently used in this presentation. So the following backends are currently available. Overall, we have five backends. Two of them are nested. That is X11 and Wayland. The X11 one is the one I use for development nowadays. The Wayland one is basically the state of last year with the Weston in between. So that hasn't changed a lot. Both of them support OpenGL and QPainter compositing, and both of them obviously have input support. On the full platform side, we provide three backends. We have the primary one, that is the direct rendering management interface. We see we still have a few problems here, like windows always go on top, so let's focus back on our presentation. Direct rendering management supports OpenGL and QPainter. we don't get input events, we use lib input for it. Then we have a frame buffer device, so just rendering to the dev fp0 that only QPainter, Mesa doesn't support OpenGL over frame buffer anymore, so that never got implemented. And obviously for our clone project, we also have a hardware composer, libhypers enabled backend. That one is a little bit special because it only supports OpenGL and it only does input. And it also does input, so we cannot use libinput on that platform, which is a little bit unfortunate, but that's the way it is. So the platforms are relatively small in code. So for example, the hardware composer backend is just around 800 lines of code, and 200 of them are mapping input event codes. The hardware composer is a little bit special because the libhypers is Apache 2 license, which is incompatible with GPL version 2. So if you use the hardware composer backend, QWin turns GPL version 3 or later. So that is a small overview about our architecture. We are nowadays a Wayland server. We support rootless xWayland. We get input events directly through libinput. We render to DRM KMS or to nested outputs like X11 or Wayland. So a little bit on the evolution of QWin. So that was the basic simplified architecture of QWin back in 2010-2011. We had our huge workspace class. So the workspace was basically everything about window management, everything about compositing, so all in one class, a proper proc object. The header was something like 2,000 lines, so changing that meant that everything in QWin got recompiled. So we have windows represented by the top level class. Top level is in the XSpeak window, which is apparent directly to the root window. From that, we subclass the client, which is the actual windows which we manage, and an unmanaged, which is what you know as perhaps overwrite redirect windows, or in Qt speak, bypass window manager hint. And as the last one, the deleted, which is when we close a window, a copy of the actual content of the window for the fade out animation. So this architecture did not serve us well for going to Wayland because we had this huge X11 dependent class. So what we did, we started splitting up. So this is now extremely simplified. And actually I want to zoom in a little bit. So what we have nowadays on the windowing front, not so much change. We still have our top level, we still have our deleted and our unmanaged, but we have a new class abstract client, which is basically an abstract interface for representing anything QWin manages. And we have introduced a new class shell client, which is for Wayland clients. So that was a huge stage, and once we had that in QWin committed a few months ago, we were able to manage Wayland clients. The workspace got split up in many different classes. So we have composer split out, but then we also have things like a screen class split out, which has either XRender specific implementation or on Wayland backend specific implementation. So by that we were able to get in the information which we need from various Wayland backends. Also, we have screen edges refactored, and we now have something like an edge, and it can be either on X11 a window edge or area-based edge, which means we get here the screen edge support. See. So the next thing about the evolution I want to talk about is actually starting up our Wayland server. So QWin traditionally is an X11 application, which means we use X11 everywhere and pretty much early the startup, and without an X server we do it. So what we needed was to start xWayland somehow. Now the problem here is in order to start xWayland, we need a Wayland server, which QWin is supposed to be. Now the Wayland server can only be started once we have an event loop, which is provided by the Q application. No, because KWin needed the XCV plugin, we needed to be on X11 for the Q application. Now, what does Q application do if you don't have an X server? It just quits, which is sensible. So overall, we had a wonderful dependency loop. So here we see it a little bit again. So the solution for this problem was obviously to move away from the XCV QPA because we cannot provide it. I got it running to start a Wayland server and X-Wayland before starting the Q application, but that caused a different problem because X-Wayland is only able to provide OpenGL support if the WLDRM interface is present, and that is only present once we have started the compositor and exported to ETL that is our Wayland server. So, yeah, it was not possible to do that, and X-Wayland especially didn't pick up later on that the interface is now available. So, we needed to change, we needed to go away from XCV and switch to Qt Wayland. And for that we needed to reorder the startup, and there our refactoring really became handy because we had now multiple areas built out of workspace, this huge X11 dependent class, and these areas were no longer X dependent. Like we had the screen class, which didn't use the X render backend, but the actual Wayland specific backend, so we were in a very comfortable state to actually reorder our startup. So now we have a startup which first starts the Wayland server, then creates a Q application. We still need to create first the Wayland server, then the Q application, because the Wayland also checks whether it can connect to to a Wayland server. Then we start up our compositor, which allows us then to start an X-Wayland server. We wait till X-Wayland is ready, and then continue with the startup of the Xcode. It's pretty fast, actually. So we have hardly any waiting time. The only waiting time is the startup of X11, and luckily that's pretty fast. But we still have similar problems as we have with XCV with the Qt Wayland plugin, and mostly our biggest problem is that Qt Wayland performs round trips in the main GUI thread. Now, because we start the Wayland server before we start the Q application, we are not able to put it into the thread because you cannot create a Q thread before you create a Q application. And that means our Wayland server currently lives in the main GUI thread. Now, Qt Wayland during startup performs a blocking round trip to the Wayland server. And at that time, our complete application is just frozen and will never wake up. So what we did was create our own event dispatcher, install it on the Qt core application, and make sure that Qt Wayland processed this event dispatcher while waiting for the events if it has not created an own event dispatcher. So with that, we got the startup solved. But nevertheless, we still have a few workaround for Qt Wayland. This is an example, like, so when you first create an OpenGL window, for example for Qt Quick, Qt tries to create an OpenGL context to check whether threaded rendering is possible and stuff like that, and it does it on the thread it's in. So if you create Qt Quick from your main GUI thread, it will create an OpenGL context in your main GUI thread. Now that's not a problem, but Mesa performs a blocking round trip to the Wayland server, and once again we are dead, frozen. So what we have here is trying to trigger the creation of a simple OpenGL window in an off-screen thread before KWin internally somewhere triggers a kill path which would create OpenGL context inside Qt. Another problem which turned out really tricky was bypass window manager hint. So bypass window manager hint means on X11 to set the override redirect flag so that the window manager doesn't manage the window. That's something which we need to do on X11 for all of our own windows. Now the flag is obviously X11 specific, resulting in KWin Wayland to say that flag doesn't make sense to us. We just don't show the window. So KWin was not able to show any of its own windows. So what we do here is we have a global event listener. We wait for any window show event. We check whether the flag is set. We destroy the window, unset the flag, create the window again, and show it again. Not nice, but it works. So the question is, wouldn't it be better to create our own QPA? I mean, after all, we have a few problems, like we cannot share the composited OpenGL context that we could pick, which would be really handy, because we could send our own window textures, which we have anyway, into the Qt context to render them. We could render Qt to a frame buffer object and completely bypass the window stuff. We intercept all input events anyway, so wherever you have a window shown zoning from KWin, KWin processes the events also on X11 and forwards it internally. We have code to create X11 failure windows, we have code to create OpenGL context. So whatever the QPA does, KWin has code for it. So maybe it would be a good idea to create our own QPA just to no longer work around issues with the QPAs. Now, one thing to make it clear, I don't think the QPAs are bad or anything, it's just KWin is special. KWin doesn't fit what the QPAs are for, neither on XCV nor on Wayland. So that's not a fault of Qt, it's just KWin doesn't fit. So the next thing I want to do talk about is the KWinD project. For that I have a quote from Kai Uwe. I propose to rename KWin to KWinD because it follows all features. So it's obviously a joke, but all jokes have some truth. The truth is that we want to fix the security issues with X11. Examples for that are that kglobalxl is a global keylogger. We don't want global keylogger features in Wayland. We want to be secure by default. We don't want that applications are able to lock your keys. So secure by default means kglobalxl cannot work anymore. We know that screen locking is completely broken on X11, so no, it just doesn't work. I blocked about it back in January. So we want to have secure screen locking. How does Plasma as a desktop shell on X11 actually manipulate windows, like sending them on a different virtual desktop? It's like modifying properties on the window of different processes. From a security perspective, that's just horrible. We allow any process to modify any aspect of a window. That's just no. Windows can place themselves. So let's assume I have here my nice Firefox and I'm serving to kde.org. And now I'm a malicious application. So what could I do? Well, I could create my own window. I could place it exactly atop of the address bar of Firefox. I could render to it that you are on kde.org and send the browser to a different location. For the user, it would look like he's on kde.org because the browser says so. But actually, it's a different window. It could steal the input. It could move the pointer. It could do whatever it wants. So from a security perspective, that's just all horrible. So we need to get away from these issues. And that means that in many, many places, we need to move more control into the compositor. We need to make sure that the compositor knows about what's going on. For example, kglobalxl moved into KWin. That was needed because we don't want global keyloggers. So KWin processes the global shortcuts directly, and by that enables global shortcuts to work without anybody else reading to input events. Similarly, we need to move screen locking into KWin. Currently my screen locks, but what I can do is just press Alt+F4 to quit the screen locker and the screen is unlocked. So yeah, we need to move screen locking into KWin, and that would give us a way better control, because then KWin knows that is the screen locker window and we can secure it, we can make sure that no other window gets input while the screen locker is shown. We can ensure that no other window gets rendered at all if the screen locker is shown. So yes, we need to move the screen locker. We need to know which window belongs to the virtual desktop. That was to the virtual keyboard. That was something we discovered during the phone project, and which will become handy for touch-enabled notebooks as well, because the virtual keyboard, we actually want to go on top of the screen locker. So there we have our first exception. And we want to place the virtual keyboard also on above full screen windows, but at the same time, we never want the virtual keyboard to get to become the active window, because that would break other applications. We need to know which process is the desktop shell, we need to know which process is the screenshot application, we need to know which process handles power management. So that are all things which need to communicate with the window manager, with the compositor, in a way that KWin has knowledge about it. And in general, we need to authorize processes to special interfaces. So for example, recently I added support for KDE Connect by implementing a fake input protocol. It's currently enabled by default, but actually we don't want that. We want to limit that, and we want users to actively say, yes, I want KDE Connect to access now my cursor and send input events. So overall it's rather tricky, because we don't want to duplicate code. I don't want K-Global Excel code pulled into KWin. I don't want to have the screen locker code pulled into KWin. So, and we also don't want to depend on specific technologies. I don't want, for example, PowerDevil to be the only application which is able to communicate with KWin regarding screen brightness, because I want KWin to be a technology not just for Plasma, but for example also for LXQt or for other smaller desktop environments which don't have the manpower to write their own Wayland compositor. We need to stay flexible in that regard. We need to have standardized protocols which allow to do that. At the same time, we don't want to harm user experience. So when, for example, the desktop shell crashes and KWin has started the desktop shell to know which one is a privileged process to access those interface, we don't want the user to nag with, hey, the process Plasma shell now wants to access the window management interface. Do you agree? So we need to find very smart solution for that. And in that regard, we also have to think about KDET, because if now KDE Connect or K-Wallet would access the special interfaces, it would be KDET 5 wants to access this interface. So it's something which needs a little bit smarter solutions. We have the problem already on X11. I think you have all seen it, that KDET asked to open the K-Wallet. And it's kind of for the user a little bit pointless to show such process names. So we need smart solutions for that. And suggestions for that are obviously appreciated. So let's have a look on what's next on the stage. So first of all, we need to add support for XCG shell. So currently we only support WL shell, and that's a rather limited interface. And we made it kind of work because there's a Qt extension, a Qt extended surface, which allows us, for example, to close windows. But overall, it's not a good solution for us yet. So we want to support Weston demo clients and GTK clients in the future as well. The XCG shell is still under heavy development, which makes it rather tricky for me to integrate it, because I need to provide wrappers for them in the KWin repository, and we provide binary stability for that. So that's a little bit tricky for me from the development point of view. And also because it's an unstable protocol, pretty much GTK, Qt, Wayland all have different versions and are not interoperable anyway. So I can only work against one. So my idea here is to work now on master to follow Wayland development in some way. And obviously we need to make sure that we get our needs into the XCG shell protocol, and that means we need to start implementing it. Different problem to solve our window decorations. So maybe you have seen my screenshots with the wonderful blue, cute client side decorations. They are ugly and they have no distinct state shown for an active window. The minimize button doesn't work because WL shell doesn't provide minimize. We cannot configure the button orders, we cannot add our own button order, our own buttons, so no on all desktops, for example. And overall, it's just not a client-side decoration. So if you compare a normal GTK application with their client-side decoration, yes, it looks good, but Qt doesn't. And Qt doesn't have an API for doing proper client-side decorations. So overall, I think this decoration architecture is not a solution for us in Plasma. I see two possible solutions. One is to implement a better plugin using KDecoration. When I rewrote KDecoration lately, I had that in mind. So it's designed that could work also in Qt Wayland. But overall, I'm more tending to disable the Qt Decor at runtime. There's an environment variable for that. We use that, for example, on the film. And we export the frameless window hint in the extended surface so that when you can know which window should have a decoration or not, and then just use our good old X11 deco for all Qt windows, and GTK applications would have their client side decorations. So hopefully that makes everybody happy. And of course, there are lots and lots of features which are still missing and which need to be implemented. Most importantly, currently we cannot move windows at all. That's a little bit of a problem, especially for dog fooding. We need to export window types so that we can have better semantics about them, so that the notifications do not pop up over our running application. We need to improve the interaction with Plasma. There's a bug for that on Tuesday. We have many, many bugs which need fixing. We need the window rules framework. We need to port the window rules framework. That's a little bit tricky because it operates on window IDs, which we normally don't have. We have a great to-do kde.org board with many, many tasks on there. And most of them are really, really easy. So if I pick a task from there, I'm mostly done in less than half an hour. So they are small tasks, and the code base is new. It's easy to get into. You can ask people who actually work on that, who normally don't contribute to KWin or Wayland, and they were able to fix their stuff. So please help. We need many people working on that. Another big topic is KWin system. KWin system is an awkward framework. So it's completely modeled about X11. It used to be even called KWin window system. Or KWin system or something like that. So it was really modeled around X11, and somewhere in the pre-4.0 area, someone had the idea of making that cross-platform and adding support for OS X and Windows, but that just never really worked because it's too X11 specific. And now, obviously, also Wayland is too different for KWindows system to work on that. So the idea we're currently toying around is to create a new API which just exposes a Qabstract item model over all windows, and that could then be used by the task manager. We already have a Qabstract item model in KWayland, which then exports all Wayland clients to Plasma. And of course we need to polish. If you want to test, you can just run a nested query or KWin on DRM with KWin_Wayland -xWayland. And if you want to start a complete Plasma session, it's start Plasma compositor from your TTY. So Plasma 5.4 will be a technology preview for Plasma on Wayland. So we are now in the stage where we can accept bug reports. And Tuesday is our Wayland day. So in the morning we have a session on Power Devil and K-Screen, then we have big session on Plasma, and in the afternoon I'm providing some help for application developers on porting the application to Wayland. Now, maybe you think, hey, I'm only using Qt and I have not no X11 specific code in it. Yes, you do. I have seen lots of application code. Our application code is old, going back to KD2 and so. So, yes, you have X11 specific code, whether you know it or not. And come to that, I have a small presentation showing you all the things you shouldn't do, and you should not do those things on X11 either. So mostly if you do that, it's also wrong on X11. And with that, I'm at the end of my presentation and open for questions. So, ideally yes, but that means that GNOME developer supported. I'm not absolutely confident that we will get that into because it's against GTK's design or GNOME's design.
Is there a GWin done on Plasma 5 to and GWin to work on Windows?
On Windows? No.
Any other questions? We've got a question, why not?
Because. We spent lots of time to remove the useless CMake switches for compiling on Windows and making all X11 optional. So be thankful that we don't do that anymore. I think it's a better choice to not do that.
Okay, any more questions? No? Okay, so thank you, Martin.